My name is Russ Altman. I'm the next person. I'm the guy with all the departmental affiliations. I'm from the department, but for today, I'm from the Department of Bioengineering. That's the one we love today. What is bioengineering? You don't really need to know that, but I think it's relevant for today. We engineer biological living matter. And I think that's why I'm here today, because we invent new molecules, new pathways by which molecules can be made, new cells, new tissues, even new organisms. So I'm kind of here to give you a technical status update on how we are doing at making Frankensteins, literally. A couple of kind of random things. First of all, this novel, if you read it, is amazingly thin on technical bioengineering detail. In fact, we heard most of it when Audrey gave her introduction. That's pretty much everything you learn. And there's been a lot added on in the movies about electricity and all kinds of things, but it is amazingly disappointing if you're a bioengineer and you're looking for some inspiration about how to do this. That's the first point. The second point is she or some movie guys, because I'm not sure how prominent electricity really is. It's kind of mentioned, but it's very vague. And in the movies, many times it became much more prominent. So whoever came up with that got incredibly lucky. Just last week at a athletic event, I saw somebody who was clinically dead get cardioverted with electrical shock, and they stood up and said, "What happened?" And it's like, dude, you were dead. You're not dead anymore. And so there's an unbelievably fortuitous element of reality from 200 years ago, when cardioversion and the electrical basis for conduction in the heart was entirely unknown. We were getting bits of it in this vitalism kind of thing that you heard about before. The third random thing that I wanted to say is that Frankenstein, the novel, anticipates many technical and ethical social issues that are incredibly germane to bioengineering today. And in fact, taken at its most literal, it is the disaster scenario for a bioengineer. Right? This is, you work hard, you have an idea, you do a project, but what happens goes totally out of control. You are clearly, well, I don't want to say clearly guilty, because we have a lawyer coming up next, but you are arguably guilty of a number of missteps in planning your project, thinking about the implications for others and for the subject that you're working on and for yourself. And so in many ways, this is what we try to make sure our students never do. And so as part of our curriculum, in addition to all the technical stuff that we teach our students, some of them may be here, is a key focus on the ethics of bioengineering and how to approach these incredible technologies and incredible capabilities that we're building that can be used for good, but can go out of control. So the three things I want to give you a status update on today are in the title. It's artificial intelligence, tissue engineering, and person-machine interfaces. And I think just to jump to the conclusion, the surprising thing is that the things that are most like Frankensteinian in terms of our efforts and what we're trying to do are not causing us the most problems. And the things that are in some way most different from what Mary Shelley describes in the novel are problematic. So let me first tell you a little non-technical update on tissue engineering. So this is the idea of taking cells, human cells, and coaxing them to become replacement tissues. So cartilage, bone, that's kind of stuff we're kind of doing now. We can kind of grow plates of cartilage, we can grow bones, we can shove them in your bone if you've had a dent in your bone for some reason, and it will grow and become part of your bone. You may have seen that people are now starting to get gels. They make, basically it's jello, where they can put the shape of an ear. They can put skin cells in those jello molds, and those skin cells will actually divide and will take on the shape of the gel, and there are little ear-like things that have been grown in the lab. Not inconsequential, because your hearing is incredibly important, is incredibly sensitive to the shape of your ear, which is incredibly well evolved to capture sound and focus it so that your eardrum has a chance of hearing what you want to hear. So we're doing ears. The big enchiladas, we'd like to be able to engineer hearts, at least heart muscle, if not an entire heart for transplant. We'd love to do pancreases, because pancreases are often gone awry in diabetes. We'd love to do livers, kidneys, and all of this is happening. The scaffolding is getting better. Our ability to find these stem cells that you've heard about that are kind of what we call pluripotent, they can turn into many different things, and with the right cajoling, they will turn into liver cells, heart cells, skin cells. And pretty much things are going along. We're not doing things that are creeping people out too much. We have methods for proposing our projects and mostly self-regulating how they're done, how they're presented, and it's going pretty well, and that's your update on tissue engineering. Another revolution, of course, that you're well aware of here in Silicon Valley is information technology. And so one thing that really isn't very much anticipated in the novel is the idea of a biological electronic interface. We can do things in silicon and with electronics that it's very hard to get cells to do right now. We hope to do it someday. That's the tissue engineering part. And just to make it real, there I have colleagues over here in engineering, in both electrical and bioengineering, who take electrodes and can put them on your brain, if you allow them, and they can make recordings of your intent to move your muscles. And of course, if you're normally abled, you will move your muscles. But there are people who've had spinal cord injuries, and they are unable to send the impulses that are formed in their brain down the spinal cord to the muscles. So initially, when we were able to make these measurements, these are electrodes in the brain, and we can say, let's see if we can get somebody who's had a spinal cord injury to control a cursor on a screen. We will ask them to think about where they want the cursor to be as if they were moving it. We will read the motor cortex, the part of the brain that makes the plans for motion, and we will then see if we can train them, and they can train themselves in the computer, to move the cursor. And 5-7 years ago, we did that. It has rapidly advanced, and you may have seen movies or television shows about this. Recently, we've had electrodes for people who've had spinal cord injuries, and they are actually moving artificial limbs. They just have to learn how to think the thought about how to move the arm. The computer electrodes read the signals in the cells, go through some algorithm that is complicated but doable, and sends impulses to the arm that says, please move. Again, it's an incredible, and then you've seen there are heartbreaking movies in a happy way of people who have not picked up a glass and drunk it in 20 years. They think about their motorized arm, they pick up the drink, they drink it, and they start crying. And it's just unbelievable. And again, this is pretty much going well. There are risks in these experimentations. A lot of the work is done on monkeys initially before it's brought to humans. It's brought to humans. The humans are well aware of the risks. Infection, putting things in your brain in general can be dangerous. It's exciting, but it is happening, and we're going to see it more. We're thinking about artificial retinas. These are electronic surfaces that can detect photons and light, send the signals back to the optic nerve to the brain, and then you get initially primitive, but eventually much better sense of sight when you have a retina that otherwise doesn't work. And so these bioelectronic interfaces are happening. You know, there are the bolts. We always wondered, I guess the bolts are the positive and negative lead. There they are. That's the idea that we're now pushing further. And then the final thing that I want to talk about, and this is the one that's weird and unexpected and is causing more problems, like what you read about in the novel, than either the tissue engineering or the bioelectronic interfaces. And this is the human the capability that's evolving in artificial intelligence. So there are no body parts here. There's no tissues. There's no bioelectronic. This is entirely in the computer. But you've seen it. Many of you are probably talking to your cell phones these days, and your cell phones are talking back. And we are now having papers published about computer programs that can look at the moles on your arm and pick the ones that look like melanoma, a cancer, and pick the other ones that don't look so bad. The ability of computers to now look at pictures and say, that's a picture, Well, in fact, it was very doable. You could say, that's a picture of Frankenstein. And there are algorithms right now that can look at that graphic and tell you what it is. But the ones that are even kind of more weird are two children playing with a dog in front of a fire truck. And then you see a picture, and you see the caption that's been written by a computer. And then self-driving cars, self-driving everything, drones. And this has more of a Frankenstein flavor in how it's going down, if you will. There's a sense of lack of control. There's a sense of creating this stuff before we fully understood the implications, the good, the bad, the self-regulation, the external regulation. These deep learning systems, as they are called, are actually based on a model similar to the human brain. There are a lot of computational neurons that take a lot of input from the outside world. They do a lot of computation, and they decide on their output. And these are advancing rapidly. You've perhaps heard that the job market is going to be threatened. It's not clear that truck driver will be a thing in 10 years. It's not clear that a whole class of jobs that are currently held by people will be needed any longer if this goes totally unchecked. So really mirroring lots of what you've heard in the last 40 minutes, that's really happening in many ways with AI. And it's not the tissue engineering, but it's this human-like capability embodied in a machine and out of control that is really the thing that's causing us the most problems. And of course, those of us in academia who worry about these things and who are trying to use them, you know, to be very simplistic, for good, not evil, are kind of surprised by this development, and it caught many of us not ready to deal with these issues. So here, at the 200th anniversary of Frankenstein, and we think about our response to monsters and what constitutes a monster, I think it's a lesson for we in bioengineering, and really we in all fields of natural science and invention, to be super vigilant at all times about what we're doing, how we're doing it, and why we're doing it, because the monster can arise from a number of sources that might not be expected.